Most everybody in this great country has heard my story about the coon hunt. I want to review it with you just for a moment and get you up to date if by chance you hadn't heard it. Because this whole nation is worried about John Eubanks, what's up in that tree. They are worried about him, and John squalling and bellering and asking for some help. And I left him up in that tree when I told my last story. And I said, Mr. Barron, that thing's eating John up. What in the world are we gonna do? And I commenced a squalling. John was a first cousin of mine. And I'd wipe them tears, and I squalled, and I said, Mr. Barron, let's do something. That thing's eating John up. Four of the dogs had done got scared and left and went to the house. Mr. Barron said, boys, we have got to do something. I don't know nothing to do except see can we make enough a racket here on the ground to get that thing's attention, and maybe it'll turn John loose and jump out of that tree. He said, you boys twist them dogs' ears, make them howl. Scream hysterical. Jerry, you get a hold to that muscadine vine over there and commence to snatching it and screaming to the top of your voice. I'll holler loud as I can and shoot this pistol six times, and maybe that thing'll turn John loose. Folks, that thing not only jumped out of that tree, but it whooped every dog on the ground. Tore both britches legs out of Mr. Barron's overhauls and run off. We ain't never hunted in that neck of them woods ever again. Come on down, John. That thing's gone. Come on down, John. That thing's gone. John started easing down that tree. That old sweet gum rosin was getting in them places where that thing had clawed him. That bark on that sweet gum tree was stinging him, and he was squalling. And just as John's foot hit the ground, my brother Sonny mocked that thing. Wah! John went right back to the top, all the way to the top. We're just joking, John. We're just joking. Come on down. John eased down that tree finally, and I armed him up and put him in my arms, and I broke and run to the house, a squalling, and I laid him down on the front porch, and I said, Mama, Mama, come here quick. Bring every bit of the medicine we got in the house. We got a Dr. John. Something has eat him up. My mother scrapped up all of the medication she could find in our shotgun modest home, brought it out there and set it down on the porch by John, and all she brought was black draught and 3-6s. I said, Mama, John don't need to swallow nothing. We need to daub something on him. We finally loaded John up in a pickup truck and took him over to Liberty, Mississippi, and the late Dr. Quinn sewed John up, and John lived to hunt again. Next Monday morning, all of us went to school, and I sure do appreciate this real wonderful classical music every now and then. I know some of y'all laugh at me about I ain't cultured enough to know how to understand good music, but I was up at Mississippi State University the other day, and I saw where the Pittsburgh Symphony Orchestra was gonna play. And I went to hear them because I understand that type of music. I had wonderful training. I took public school music at East Fork Consolidated High School. That was the only mandatory course we had in the whole school system. You didn't have no choice, you had to take it. Miss Minnelly Stone was our teacher. And whenever she knocked on the door and come in, didn't make no difference what course you was a-studying. You shut them books up and paid attention to her. One day she entered the ninth grade class where me and Marcel Ledbetter and his younger brother Claude, Ardell and Burnell Jones and Will Manell and Ray Nell and Christine and W.L. and Ardell and Burnell and Sonny and Jerry Clower made up that class. Miss Minnelly Stone come walking in She had two young'uns with her, a toting pasteboard boxes what had public school music instruments in them. Oh, we was gonna be members of the public school music band. If you acted real nice, she let you whoop them sticks together. Whop them sticks. And if you was good for two class meetings hand running, you could whop that tambourine. And if you was real good, you could hold that little triangle and take that little steel bar and tinky, tinky, tink on that triangle. Now, brother, if you could tinky, tinky, tink on the triangle, that was the leading instrument in the public school band. This particular day, she was all excited. Miss Minnelly Stone said, "Class, you know I have always regretted very much that none of y'all have ever heard no world-renowned musician. But Mr. Delsey, what's a world-famous piano player, is coming to Macomb to visit with his mama. I have written to him, and he's coming to East Fork to play for the chapel program, and y'all gonna get to hear a world-renowned piano player." The day he showed up, they made all of us go into the main big room where the piano was. They roped off the public school music group, made us sit as a group. And Miss Minnelly Stone explained to us that this year Mr. Delsey was going to be playing one of them concerto overtures what he had been playing in the minors. And or for the minors, one or the other, I remember it distinctly. Them minors was involved in it one way or the other. And she said, "Class, if you will pay attention to this great artist, you can see in story form what it is he's playing." And we listened real good. Now, folks, that ain't the first time he had ever played one of them pianos. Whoo, he could forevermore whoop up on a piano. Every now and then, he'd forget what piece it was he was a-playing, and he'd just freeze. But in a second or two, he'd think of it, and brother, he would take off one more time. I'll tell you that. He'd take off again. Soon as he got done playing, they dismissed everybody except that group what was roped off. And they went to their classes. Miss Minnelly Stone had done started squalling. It had done got her to her so well. And she is squalling and saying, "Class, wasn't that wonderful? Now tell the teacher, what did you see? Some of you girls, what did you see?" Christine throwed her hand up. "Yes, Christine, what did you see?" "Oh, Miss Minley, I saw a little deer running through the wood." "Oh, marvelous, Christine. Wonderful, wonderful. You thrill me to death. Will Manel, what did you see, Will Manel?" Will Manel jumped up and said, "Oh, Miss Minley, I saw the little deer take a drink out of the bubbling brook while the water was pouring over the dam." "Oh, God bless you, Will Manel. I'm so proud of this class. Let's hear from some of you boys." "Claude Ledbetter. Claude Ledbetter. Ma'am, what did you see, Claude?" Claude rammed both hands in his overhaul pockets up to his elbow. He commenced to squirming and rubbing his bare feet on the floor. He spun all the way around in the desk. The desk wasn't anchored to the floor at East Fork School. "I ain't gonna lie about it. I ain't seen nothing. But I heard that dam when it busted." The next morning, it was a Monday morning, and my mama told me to get on the school bus and tell all of my friends on there that we was going to have a rat killing Saturday. I got on the school bus and I said, "We're going to have a rat killing Saturday." Them folks come from all over the county with the dogs and the sticks to help us kill them rats. One day we worked our way to the far corner, and there's just a whole bunch of them rats flushed out of that corn crib at the same time. It was so many of them that broke through the ranks and run and got under a big concrete slab. And we couldn't get them out from under there. We dug, we drawed up water and poured down them holes, tried to drown them. And directly Uncle Versy Ledbetter, my closest neighbor, and he was a head rat killer. in our community. He said, boys, I tell you what we got to do. I am told if we can get that A-model car cranked, yonder, and back it up to that concrete slab, and put that inner tube around the exhaust pipe, and run the other end of that inner tube down under that concrete slab, and get that old truck cranked and go to racing that motor, I am told it hit manufacture something up in that engine that when you guff it down through that exhaust pipe, it'll make them come out from under that. Uncle Bercy got her cranked and reeled that motor up. Wobbum, wobbum. Now, folks, y'all ain't never had no fun unless you have stood with a stick waiting for them carbon monoxide sick rats to come out from under that slab. Now, that is some fun. One day while we were having a rat killing, me and my brother Sonny was up in the corn crib a-moving the corn and killing them rats as we got to them. Directly, my brother Sonny caught a big one in the throat. It was the most hugest rat I have ever seen in all my life. His tail hung way down. It was such a fine rat that my brother Sonny wanted to show it to Mama. He jumped out of the corn crib and commenced to running toward the house, hollering, Mama, Mama, look a here, what a rat. Now, my brother Sonny didn't know that Reverend Brock, the Baptist preacher, was in the house a-visiting with Mama. But Sonny run on in the back door and run in the living room. Mama was sitting over in one corner and the preacher in the other, and Sonny ain't seen the preacher yet. He rushed on in the living room and said, Mama, look a here, what a rat. I done whooped him over the head with a ear of corn. I done jobbed him with a hay fork. I done stripped all the hide off of his tail. I done whooped him up and down on the floor of that corn crib. I done stomped him 3 or 4 times. And Sonny saw the preacher. And he hugged that rat up to his chest and commenced to fondling it and stroking it and crying. And then the Lord called the poor thing home. I think the greatest claim to fame at LSU has had in recent years is this here Pistol Pete Maravich, this basketball player. Y'all seen him, ain't you? Ain't you seen him? He ain't real. He ain't real. He really ain't. He just uses his right hand to play basketball. He don't use his left hand at all. And any time you're such a great athlete that you can bounce a basketball with your right hand and signed for $3 million to a pro contract, you something another good or why? I'll tell you that. I done seen him in the real live flesh when he played at LSU and now that he is playing for the Atlanta Hawks. And anytime you can bounce that basketball with your right hand and take your left hand to hold a high out of your eyes to see where you going, you some kind of fine athlete, I'll tell you that. If Pete had got a haircut, he'd have signed for at least $5 million. Because you can just play better using both hands, ain't no doubt about it. I found that out at East Fork Consolidated High School years ago. Now, I think all of you need to know where I'm from. You would understand and appreciate my stories a heap more. I grew up 12 miles west of Macomb, Mississippi, and 65 miles due northeast of Baton Rouge, Louisiana. Now, y'all know where Baton Rouge, Louisiana is. That's where this year LSU is located. Them Fighting Tigers. That good football team. I was over in Alabama the other day, and them Auburn people kept a-pestering me. They said, yeah, that's that bunch that plays so good in the rain. And then one of them would say, if it hadn't been raining, we'd have beat them last year. I said, I got news for you War Eagle Auburn folks. Us Mississippi State people have been playing LSU hand running for years. And them Tigers are bad, wet or dry. Not too long ago, I got a telephone call. A man called me and I picked up the phone and said, this is Jerry Clower from Yazoo City, Mississippi talking. He said, I'd like to know if you would come and speak to the Cattle Feeders Association in California. I said, sir, where are you having your meeting? He said, Yosemite National Park. I said, Yosemite. That's a wonderful place.
He said, it's Yosemite. I said, Dawser, Miss Robinson at East Fork Consolidated High School at Route 4 Liberty, Mississippi, taught me that that was Yosemite. And as well as I remember, that ain't too far from the Mojave Desert. He said, well, sir, I don't know how much it'll cost you to get you out here, but we need you to come and speak to us. So me and Mama flew out there on one of them big Delta jets. Now, that was about the finest trip I have ever took in all of my life. I've been criticizing some of the young men in this country about the hairdo that they work on. But y'all ought to have seen the hairdo of them ladies what was serving folks on that airplane. It beat all I ever heard of in my lifetime. One of them ladies had her hair whooped around over her right eye and then down. She is blind in her right eye. Then she had three strands of hair pulled down across this left eye right here. And she is coming down the aisle a-walking and stepping real high just like a blind bridle on a brand new mule. I said, lady, if you don't get that hair out of your face, you can see where you going, you gonna scald somebody with that hot coffee. And I'll tell you something else, ain't no sense in them wearing them dresses as short as they is wearing. I'll tell you that. As long as she stood straight and walked straight and normal, it is all right. But when she reached up to get a pillar up on that overhead there, there ain't no sense in that. And after she reached and got the first pillar, I was the only man on there what didn't ask for a pillar then. Down at East Fork Community of Amite County, Mississippi, I had the privilege of growing up with a gentleman by the name of Kirk Garner. Kirk Garner was a very religious fellow. He was in church every time them church doors opened. And one day he walked out on the front porch and an airplane had just finished doing some skywriting. Kirk didn't know that no airplane could do that. The airplane was gone and the words what that plane wrote was kind of fading out. Kirk stood on the front porch and looked at it and broke and run back in the house and told his wife, Callie, says it's judgment. God's done wrote it in the sky. Callie said, Kirk, I don't hear no horns blowing and no bells ringing. I don't believe it's judgment. It aggravated Kirk to the extent he broke and run, jumped off the front porch, tripped and fell over the faucet. He had drove into the ground to make folks think he had running water. Actually, Kirk toted water a mile and a half from a branch back behind his house. Great big antenna stretched across the roof, and Kirk didn't even know what a radio was, much less have one. But he hit that dirt road, and he started running toward my daddy's house. And he was kicking up dust, brother. He was scared to death that judgment was there. Mr. Halley, a man down the road, saw him coming and knew something was bad wrong with Kirk running that fast or kicking up that dust, and he got out in the middle of the road and bear-hugged him when he come by and stopped him. Slow down, Kirk. What in the world's happening? He said, Mr. Halley, it's judgment. Why would you say that, Kirk? I saw it wrote in the sky. God's done wrote it up at judgment. Mr. Halley said, Kirk, that's Pepsi Cola. Sir, that's Pepsi Cola, Kirk. An airplane wrote that up there, and the airplane's been gone 5 minutes, and you just saw that writing. Oh, Mr. Halley, you know that ain't no Pepsi Cola. Said, yes, it is. The airplane wrote it and done gone. So you just calm down. It ain't judgment. The next morning, Kirk came down to my daddy's house, and they're standing out in the backyard, and Kirk was telling my papa this story. And daddy asked him, said, Kirk, what would you have done had it been judgment? He said, I was just going to keep running till judgment overtook me. Several of you have asked me about Marcel Ledbetter my closest friend and lifelong companion,
what took a lightweight McCullough chainsaw and run everybody out of a beer joint.
Now, I have talked to the McCullough chainsaw people,
and I want y'all to know that they do not, and I do not recommend that you use a chainsaw in that fashion. But for what they recommend their product to be used for, it is as good as a chainsaw you'll be able to buy anywhere. Marcel even hung him around on each side of his secondhand putwood truck, made him some holsters for him after he tore up that beer joint. You know, he didn't have no cab on his putwood truck. His head stuck up about 6 inches above the windshield, and he never wore nothing but just a pair of overalls, nothing else. He always kept the top button buttoned on the side if it was kind of cool weather. But if it was scalding hot, he undone that top button and just let them flop. Just let it flop. Now, Marcel Ledbetter was my closest friend. He was a great fella. And several people have asked me, did Marcel ever get into any trouble other than taking the chainsaw and tearing up the beer joint? I'll have to admit that Marcel got into some trouble one time before that. But Marcel and his younger brother Claude, to tell you about the trouble they got in, sneaked in early one morning to the East Fork Church and poured all of the grape juice out of the communion bottles and replaced it with green persimmon wine. The next Lord's Day, they served the Lord's Supper. And everybody in the church house partook.
The preacher got up and said, as is now our custom, we'll sing a song and go out. They all had to stand and whistle the closing hymn. I want to run down the Ledbetter family for y'all just a little bit. They were my closest neighbor. They're great people. And I think back on my childhood days, there's nobody I love any more than that whole family of Ledbetters. Uncle Versy Ledbetter was the mainmost one. He was the papa of them all. His greatest feat, I guess, that he was the proudest of was a coon dog named Highball. If I'm lying, I'm dying. Highball's fame was all over the world. Rich folks would bring coon dogs there to try to outdo Highball. Highball was known throughout that country as being the grittiest coon dog in all the world. He is bad. Man, he'd go in on one anywhere, anytime. Highball was something another ferocious a while. He is bad. Uncle Versy was down in the swamps hunting one night, and the biggest coon ever been in Abbott River swamps, and Highball tied up in a death-to-death battle. I mean, they wallered down a bunch of ground there. Uncle Versy hollering, get him, Highball, you can do it, darling, you can do it, put it to him. And you could hear Uncle Versy all over them swamps. Oh, Highball, put it on him, put it on him. And it ended up in such a ferocious battle that they got up on the railroad track. And one of them fast trains, the city of New Orleans on the main line of Mid-America, the Illinois Central, run over Highball and that coon and killed both of them graveyard dead while they was fighting. And Uncle Versy commenced to squalling. You could hear him moaning all over them swamps. And I throwed my arms around him and I said, Uncle Versy, you got several other puppies. What's the sons of Highball? They'll be great as him. Don't cry. I said, boy, I ain't crying because a dog got killed. I ain't that crazy. The thing that's bothering me, poor Highball might have died thinking that coon killed him. Wherever I go, people ask me, Jerry, was you lying about your football playing days at Mississippi State University? And I'm a little bit hurt wherever I go if somebody don't rush up to me and say, Jerry, I remember when you played football at Mississippi State. Well, I can tell you about a lot of things that happened to me when I was playing football. One of the reasons I wanted to transfer from Southwest Mississippi Junior College to Mississippi State to play football in the Southeastern Conference was because Mississippi State played Baylor University, that good Baptist school in the Southwest Conference. Oh, and when I was signed to a scholarship at Mississippi State, I called my mama long distance at the country store and had them to go over and get her and bring her over out to the telephone. I said, Mama, just think, your poor little old country boy is going to play against the largest Baptist university in the world. Ooh, I got ready for them people. I didn't miss prayer meeting for a whole year. I got ready for them. I knowed they was the same kind of Baptist I was. Ooh, them folks was ugly to me. I'm telling you. Every Monday morning, we would get the scouting report of the team that we was going to play next Saturday. Well, naturally, when we got ready to play Baylor, I got the scouting report, and I looked down it hurriedly to see who the man was I was going to play in front of what played for Baylor. If I'm lying, I'm dying. You know what he said about a guard named Rayfield? Big, aggressive, tough, likes to play it mean. In fact, when he was ordained as a Baptist preacher, he had two black eyes. We played Baylor in Memphis, Tennessee that year. That Adrian Burke was a chunking that football, a chunking it to a fellow named Isbell. The coach sent word, Jerry, that quarterback's got too much time to throw the ball. You get to him quick. I rushed back in there with every fiber of my being. I reached for him, and I was just before getting my hands on him, and that preacher Rayfield forearmed me back of my head. Shoved my face down in that dirt and in that grass, and my bottom lip and bottom teeth just scooped up a big mouthful of that dirt like a drag line. I jumped up, spitting and knocking the grass and the dirt out of my mouth, and I said, fella, you the dirtiest thing I ever played against in all my life, and you're supposed to be a Baptist preacher playing for Baylor. And he stood up erect. They had done throwed the ball for a touchdown. He stood up erect and popped his hand over his heart, and he pointed his long finger right in my face. He said, the Bible says, the meek shall inherit the earth. And I had just inherited a mouth plumb full of it, I'll tell you that. He was the meanest young'un has ever been in Southwest Mississippi. He holds a record yet. And Uncle Versus spent about half of his time whooping Eugene. Now, he was forever more mean, just into something all the time. I remember one day Aunt Daisy DeLauder went over there, walked from her house to take one of them mission books to Mrs. Ledbetter. They was going to try to study some kind of book, and Aunt Daisy could read. And she talked the book, and Aunt Daisy walked up the front stump, and she heard something growling and dust coming out from under the doorsteps, and there come Eugene out from under that doorstep on his all fours, a growling and a barking like a dog, and bit Aunt Daisy on the leg. Just bit a chunk out of her leg. Boy, get back. What in the world are you doing? He said, I'm playing dog. Can't you see? Uncle Bursey run out there and got a dried brush broom and commenced a whooping Eugene. I've told you about that dog game you play. You done bit Aunt Daisy. And they brought her in the house and set her down on the bench, what set alongside the dining room table. And Eugene come walking in. Uncle Bursa said, you gonna tell her you sorry for biting her? And Aunt Daisy said, oh, I just know you want to be a sweet little boy. And Eugene said, sweet? you want something sweet. And he reached and grabbed the syrup pitcher and popped the top off of it and turned that syrup pitcher bottom upwards on Aunt Daisy's head. And them syrup commenced to pouring down over her ears and a running in her hair. And Uncle Versa carried him out in the backyard and commenced to beating him, and you could have heard him all over that country. I run out there and said, Uncle Versa, please don't beat Eugene no more. This is awful. Let him go to the swimming hole with me. Said, all right, but you water them chickens, Eugene, before you go. Eugene run out there and raised up a chicken coop and caught four of the biggest, finest fryers you ever saw and come back and jobbed them down in the water well and let the bucket down on them and said, y'all drink. Drink plenty of it. And let the well bucket unwind down on them, palusha, right down in the well. Now, folks, they drawed feathers, chicken bones, and every other kind of thing you can imagine out of that well. And it took about 6 months to draw it out clean enough to where they could drink water out of it. Eugene was forevermore bad. Bad a while. I recall one time me and my brother Sonny was going to the grist mill. That's where you take corn to have it ground up for cornbread, if y'all ain't cultured enough to know what a grist mill is. We was driving by the Ledbetter house with our mules and wagon, and we heard the awfulest racket you ever heard in all of your life. My brother Sonny stopped the mule and the wagon. He said, Jerry, listen, that sounds like some kind of animal in distress. Honk, 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 honk. And I said, man, let's get away from here. That's some kind of varmint. Sonny said, that's coming out from behind that Ledbetter house. Ain't no telling what Eugene's doing. And about that time, coming around the house from the back side of the Ledbetter home was a black and tan hound, what was howling and had his paws up over his eyes a-raking, and he was white as he could be, and it was obvious soap suds was all over him. Oh, oh, and he was scratching and rolling over on the ground and bellering. And Sonny said, man, tie these mules. Let's go around there and see what in the world is going on. We walked around on the porch, and there was Eugene Ledbetter. Had four hounds up in a washing machine. Uncle Bursa had the only washing machine in Amit County. It was one of them gasoline engine types. And had one of them boards in there, what's that, proop, 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 black and forth, back and forth. And he had four black and tan hounds over in there and had his mama's battling board and a great big box of octagon soap powder. And every time one would stick his head up, Eugene would shove him back down in there. And Sonny said, Eugene, what are you doing? He said, I'm gonna wash these dogs if it takes the rest of the evening. We finally got him to let them dogs out of that washing machine and come on and go to the grist mill with us. If you asked an adult old as I am what growed up in the country, we were taught some manners when we were young'uns. We had manners, I'll tell you now. Never ever would you be caught taking the last piece of chicken off of the plate or the last biscuit. Now, you'd sit there and want it some kind of bad, but you knowed better than to take it off of the plate. I finished supper one evening and went over to the Ledbetter house, and they was eating supper. And they was all sitting around the table there, Marcel and Claude and Eugene and Aunt Pet Ledbetter, Mrs. Ledbetter, as everybody affectionately called her, and they called Mr. Ledbetter Uncle Versy. Well, they was all sitting around the table, and there's one piece of chicken left right in the middle of the platter. And all of them was a-sitting there looking at it. A wind come up and blowed the lamp out.
And you could hear Uncle Versus scream just like lightning had struck him. And Aunt Pet jumped up and finally got the lamp lit, and there was five forks sticking in the back of Uncle Versus' hand. Do y'all know what a double fireplace is? Me and my brother Sonny and my mama lived in a house one time what had a double fireplace. What that means is you sit in the one room in front of the fireplace, and right directly across the back side of that fire is another fireplace what's hooked to the same chimney. I was as scared of the dark as any man who ever lived, or any young'un who ever lived, I'll guarantee you. My brother Sonny would always make me sit in front of this fireplace until I'd get so sleepy that I'd fall out in the floor or either have to walk around in the dark by myself and go to bed. This night, he sweated me until I went on in there. I felt my way around through the kitchen and through the side room and then back into the bed. And when I got back into the bedroom on the other side of the fireplace, I saw Mama had moved the furniture. Every night, Sonny, after I got in the bed and got it warm, he'd get him a big running start. Boogity, 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 here he'd come. And he'd leave the floor and jump up in my back up in the middle of that bed. Just as I walked into the room, there is the bed right by the door. Over yonder where the bed used to be is a shiffer robe. And I was laying there thinking, I said, do you reckon Sonny knows that Mama has moved this bed? Directly I heard him coming. Boogity, 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 here he come. I felt the air from him when he run by the door right there where I was laying. And his feet left the floor, and it sounded like for several seconds he is up in the air. Boom, 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 boom. He come down flat of his stomach, skeeted across that old wooden floor, and his head hit the wall on the far side of that room, right up under the shipper robe, boom, and jarred the whole house. Here come Mama with the lamp, holding up over her head. What in the world has happened to you young'uns? And I'm laying there in the bed giggling. Oh, good gracious alive. Sonny was squalling. We got him up out of the middle of the floor and lit the other lamp, and we picked splinters out of him and daubed mercure comb on him till daylight. It took that long to get enough of mercure comb daubed on him where all them splinters had stuck into him. When I was a little boy, one of the prized possessions that I had was a coon dog named Little Red. Little Red, he was the runt of the litter, and I fed him with a bottle, and I looked after him, and I worked with him, and he grew up to be an outstanding coon dog. It was a prized possession of mine. One night we were hunting down in the swamps, and Little Red got cut on a cross-cut saw. I picked him up and started crying and held his back leg where that saw had cut him, and every time his heart would beat, blood would gush from his leg. We loaded him up in an old rattly-trap Ford car, and my brother Sonny finally got it cranked, and we rushed to Macomb, Mississippi, and I was crying, holding my coon dog. We rushed to Gillis's drugstore, walked up on the sidewalk, and the store was already closed, but there was a light on in the back. Mr. Gillis was counting the day's receipts. We bumped on the door, and Mr. Gillis come and opened the door and said, what do you boys want? And there we stood with our overalls on, dog blood all over me, scared to death. My brother Sonny said, Mr. Gillis, we understand as a veterinarian rents an office from you. Is there any way we can see him? Jerry's coon dog, Little Red, is bleeding to death. He said, boys, I'm sorry, but Dr. Williams is out of town, and he won't be back until tomorrow. But bring your coon dog on in my store. Put him down on the floor, and let me get the lights on. Let me see if I can help you.
Now, Mr. and Mrs. Adult, what would you have done? Would you have said, get that filthy dog off of this sidewalk. Look at the blood you done put down here. Yes, you could have run me off, and I'd have hated you the rest of my life. Ever since that night, I've been looking for a boy with a hurt dog. Because Mr. Norman B. Gillis showed me how adult people are supposed to set the proper example for young people to follow. He called his family physician and asked him how to put a pressure bandage on little Red's leg. He gave him some pills. He said, son, you go on home. I'll put your dog on my back porch. And Dr. Williams will see him first thing in the morning. Little Red lived to hunt again. And I thank God for men like Norman B. Gillis Sr. because he showed a young boy, a little teenager, how adult people are supposed to treat youngsters with problems.